We're going to sing a song this morning. It's a credo song, so it's a chance for us to just sing in unity and just declare what we as Christians believe our core values, what we believe in.
Father, So as we celebrate as a community here today, one of the things we celebrate is this weekend there are two baptisms. Isn't that exciting? There are two baptisms, but they don't take place on Sunday, they take place on Saturday. And they're out in the country outside of Inman. So if you're interested in being a part of that, what you need to do is go to the Student Development Office and RSVP. So sign your name. They'd like to know approximately how many plan to come. So Saturday, 6:30 p.m., that's when both baptisms take place. And we're going to celebrate with them because God transforms and He changes our life, right? He makes things new. He really makes us what it really means to be human. And we talked about that this school year. So we've said, okay, the gospel cares for the lost and hurting. What does that look like for me to really walk in someone else's shoes? Really, are there steps somewhere? What do we need to do? So we listened to Mayuko share her story of how the gospel changed her life personally and what that looks like. Last Friday, if you were here, you heard Jars, and they talked about what this looks like corporately or on a global scale when the gospel changes us. And we say, I want to share that with other people. I want other people to have God's word in their language, and we take it to them. But what about us? What about you? What about you as a student or a professor? What about you as a coach? What does this look like? Then when I say the gospel then changes me, how do I walk in someone's shoes? Do you guys agree with me that this can be difficult sometimes? Do you find it difficult? Anybody like me? Amen for that? I tell you what I found myself doing. See, this is you. I thought, well, I love God and I love others, and this is what it looks like. So I kind of do this, I dress like this, so people who love God must look kind of like me. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was kind of trying to make maybe mini-me's or something like that. You know, if they love God, surely they would look like me, right? I didn't even realize that's what I was doing, but here's how I knew I was doing it, by the things I was thinking about other people in their life. I wasn't walking in their shoes, but I was thinking, oh, they surely should maybe look like me. So we want to walk in other people's shoes because we truly care. But what does this look like on a personal level? How about this? This is getting really personal with you guys. I sometimes feel like just saying, don't do that. Like, stop it. Is that really what it's about? Like, don't do that. But that's not really the core of what we're about, is it? As followers of Jesus, that's really not even the main thing that's going on. But somehow that starts to be what I want to say. I want people to be mini-me's, maybe, and look like me, or do what I do, and listen to what I do. Or maybe what I want to do is just say, stop doing that. But that's not really what it's about. And I struggle. I sometimes say, what do I do? How do I live this out personally? There's a video that maybe some of you have seen that really, maybe this is what it's like. So check this out right here.
Proverbs. If I may digress for a moment from my prepared message, I mean it when I say to you, you guys, sometimes you're bad. Don't be jerks. You're supposed to be good. I'm in my office every day, and somebody comes in, and they're like, hey, whoops. I'm like, don't! Dan, what is your deal? If anybody doesn't know, Dan is the worst. I took a vow to not say who was the worst, but it's Dan. You guys are making me look bad in front of God. What's that? Oh, look, it's Jesus. And he said, stop it! The word of the Lord. Stop it!
All right, so is that you? Is that me? I mean, what does it look like for us to live this out individually? Say walking in their shoes really looks like. Because that's not it, right? We laugh at that, but we don't want to just say stop it. That's not what it's really about. I think one way for us to figure out what it looks like to walk in other people's shoes is to listen to each other's stories. So this morning we're going to listen to a couple of your guys' fellow students, a couple of seniors who've walked along this road together and see what that looks like. And I want you to notice a couple of things. That sometimes the paths that people have walked, where they walked in their shoes, is not quite like what we thought maybe it was. Maybe, just maybe, we've reacted a little bit like what we've seen in the video. So, first I'd like to have Olivia come up. She's a senior this year.
Content, very content with where I'm at. sophomore year, I started going down. It was like, it was just horrible. Everything just started falling down. I was making the wrong decisions, guys. And then my junior year, as you all know, if you know me, I tore my knee up really bad. I tore 3 of the major ligaments of the 4 of your knee at the same time. And so I was depressed. I was at an extreme, extreme low. Like, it was bad. God literally, he had to sit me down to make me realize, Olivia, what are you doing? Like, well, what's going on? This is not who you were raised to be. This is not what I called you to do. So why are you running around here, running away from your responsibilities, running away from your problems and everything? So the year after that, I started, making a little climb, like, rising up and stuff. It felt good. Yeah. And then I stopped running away from who I was. And things started escalating up and getting higher, and I started reaching my way back. And, I lost a couple friends. I mean, I was okay with that. They really were my friends from the beginning, obviously. I mean, I felt alone, but I knew I wasn't. Then God started dealing with me in a new way. Like, he changed me in that season. He taught me patience. He taught me gentleness. He taught me how to relate to other people. He made me sit down and be observant. And then after that, after you tear your knee up that bad, only 20% of athletes come back, especially female athletes. Once you tear your ACL, you're done. And I went to national in track. Who doesn't? Like, that's God. Like, you don't come back from that stuff and then, oh, now you're running really fast. No, you're supposed to be like a turtle.
So yesterday when we were talking about some of the things that you faced and how you consider that a great turning point in your journey, actually being injured is something that helped you along those lines. What are some of the things you had to face? Can I point out one that I was surprised that you said?
Okay.
Insecure. Did you have
Super insecure.
Okay, I got it since we asked for hands before. How many of you are surprised at that? Because I was. Anybody else surprised at that?
Okay, we have a little bit of... They're liars. super insecure. Like, so I'm that kid that when I see a pretty girl, like with the whole makeup on fleek and she got the wings on her and stuff like that, and, like, she's sitting all, and I'm like, I was like, man, I want to be that girl. Like, she is pretty. Like, and then if she sat by me, I was like, oh my gosh, don't say anything stupid, Olivia. She's gonna talk to her friends about you. That was me.
Yeah, see, that just blows me away, right?
Yes.
So what about your faith journey now? Where are you at right now? What's taking place?
Growth every single day. I'm learning patience. I am so patient. What short person do you know that is patient? Except, look at me. I mean, like, little people, Napoleon. You know me, I'm a fast walker, and I'm definitely not taking my time. So, I was like, yeah.
You mentioned a number of times like this, running away from God. Would you say at this point you're still running from God?
I didn't want to do this. Do you think I want to sit up here and talk? No. But I've learned to stop running. I've learned to actually sit down and let him do with me how he wants to do it. Let him use me like how he wants to use me. I learned that anytime I come in contact with a person, that either that's who I used to be and I need to help me get out of their rut, it's a reflection of myself, or maybe it's somebody that has been where I'm at and they're gonna help me get to my next spot in the work with God.
All right, yeah. So what's one thing if you could say to your classmates, now that you're in your senior year, what would you say? Hey guys, I just wanna encourage you in this.
Okay guys, don't be afraid to be who you were supposed to be. At the end of the day, it's only you and God. It's not you and your boyfriend, God. It's not you and your girlfriend, or your mom and dad. No, nobody's holding your hand. Whenever we all die, and when we're supposed to go, it's you and him. And at night, you have to look in the mirror and look at yourself and say, am I happy with who I am today? Am I happy with who I was, with the decisions I made? Like, you have to make sure that it's right with you and God. Because if it's right with you and God, it'll be right with you and everybody else.
All right. Thank you very much, Olivia. Can you guys tell me? As well, when we put ourselves in someone else's shoes, and I think for me to hear that she was shy because people have placed expectations on her, that she still is insecure, I think it was like this go-get-it basketball player who's confident in who she is, but put myself in her shoes changes things. Next, Jake, who leads our Friday worship band, is going to share his story.
Shawnee, Oklahoma, and I moved to Oklahoma City when I was 14.
Yeah, and yesterday you said I moved to the city when I was 14. I'm like, moved to the city? What does that mean? I guess in Oklahoma, if you move to the city, it's Oklahoma.
Yeah, okay.
All right, so describe your childhood. It's quite a bit different than what Olivia experienced in her childhood.
Yeah, so I grew up in the church. I grew up in a really broken home, and there were times where I didn't eat at night, and there were a lot of times where my dad wasn't around. Just a really broken home, a lot of fighting in my family, and it was really, really tough. But growing up in that, that's what I thought life was. And
you know, when we talked about it, you also described a lot of arguing or fighting as well. That was consistent.
Yeah.
And so tell me a little bit more about that. You and I have talked about your journey with your father as well. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so my dad was a musician, and he played guitar, and he tried to sing. but I remember when I was little, because all of our relationships in the house were really bad, and he would always try to teach me guitar, and I refused, because I refused to learn guitar, because that was a huge passion of his, and I hated my dad, and I wouldn't listen to any music with guitar. I hated rock, or I hated anything with guitar riffs because of him. And my relationship with my dad was awful because he wasn't around. He wouldn't go to my basketball games, he wouldn't go to my football games, he wouldn't go to my track meets, like he wouldn't go to any of my performances. Because when I was about 9 years old, my mom sat me and my older sister down. She's 4 years older than me. And she sat us down and had a long talk with us about why my dad wasn't around and why things were the way they were. And my mom was always at work. She was the one putting food on the table. My dad was the one taking food off the table. And she told us that he was a meth addict, and he was an alcoholic, which I knew because there's always drinks in the house, and just all these bad things that he's done. And looking back now, like, mental illness runs on both sides of my family, and my dad suffered from depression, and especially after his mom died, just before I was born. So I was kind of born into the aftermath of that effect on him.
So somehow, though, you're right here, right now. So there's a faith journey incorporated in this, and also your father has passed away. Can you share that, and where's your faith journey in all of this?
Yeah, so my dad died a month after I was saved, and that was in summer of 2010. And it was, my dad has a lot to do with my journey, even though he wasn't in my life present at all, which is kind of ironic. And so when I was saved around that time, he had been on meth for about 5-6 years, and when you're hooked that long on something like that, there's no coming back, really. It's a miracle. And he tried everything. We even sent him to rehab and he ran away. And because he would always come back to us and apologize, and he would always say, I'm gonna get better. I'm serious this time. And he would just screw up, get kicked out, he would come back, apologize, say things over and over. And especially my freshman year of high school. And it was just the same thing, and I was just sick of it, and I was sick of his apologies, because I knew when he was going to apologize, he was going to go to school. And I disconnected myself from him and from a lot of people, especially my family. And but around that time, there was one time when he did come back from rehab, and he apologized to me, and I looked in his eyes, like I could tell, like deep down, that he was serious. But now looking back, I can see that he physically couldn't do anything because of how good he was. And
now, as you described that story to me, you also said, so you became a Christian, and then your dad, he not only passes away, and you experience that, and you have that struggle, but then he's hanging on for a little while in the hospital, 2 weeks, approximately. But during that time, you're having this faith walk, you're having this conversation with God. What was that like?
Yeah, so my dad, so he got a lot better. He got a really good job. He was a professional painter. He painted all kinds of huge buildings and stuff like that. And he got a really good job. I could tell he was really trying. And I was beginning to be able to trust him. And just learning what trust is. And especially after I got saved, just learning more about who God is and who this person Jesus is. And about exactly a month after I was saved, in July, around July 15th, he hurt himself at work, his shoulder, and for a whole week, it got worse and worse and worse, and finally on a Sunday, he was almost paralyzed. He couldn't move. And I remember going to church and then getting a call at church from my mom. And while she was on the phone with me, he was having a heart attack in the hospital. And so that whole week, we thought it was a shoulder, but he was having like heart attacks. He was diabetic, didn't take care of himself very well. And so him being in the hospital really scared me. Because he went to ICU, he was in for about a week or something, and they took really good care of him, he got a lot better. And I just remember thinking, okay, God, this is really scary. But when he came home with a defibrillator, ear vest, and had a heart monitor, so if it detected anything, it would go off and like reset. It's supposed to reset his heart. And so he was home for about 3 days, and he was supposed to be able to move around a lot or eating certain things. And he loved to eat. So I caught him in the kitchen one morning, and I was like, "You're not supposed to be doing this. Go lay down." And I heard him in the kitchen again, and I ignored it. And then shortly after, I heard that alarm go off. And so my dad had a heart attack and a seizure at the foot of my mom's bed. And I witnessed that whole thing, watched my dad die in my mom's arms in her bedroom. And so following that, he was back in ICU. He was brain dead. The only thing that worked was his heart. And it was really tough seeing my dad in the hospital bed and not being able to respond. And I had no words. And at the time, I was really confused because I felt like that I was saved. I was beginning to learn how to trust my dad. And I was so confused because I feel like I was just giving my dad back in my life. But God said it would take him away all of a sudden. And, being away from him for a month, I had all these questions and I was frustrated with God, and I just remember one day, you know, I was babysitting my baby sister, but I was sitting in the room by myself, and I was so confused and frustrated, and I was just crying to God and just waiting for him to tell me it's going to be okay. But I couldn't feel him, and I didn't know how to look for him, and until I started screaming his name, and you know, I was cursing him, and like I just started getting my dad back, and you take him away from me just like that. Like, I don't understand. And
can I interrupt for a second? Because the first time I heard his story, so we're staying in their shoes, right? How many of you guys picture him leading us in the song, Good, Good Father? Don't you picture that? I picture him leading us in that. And we're declaring to God, you're a good, good father. But he shares his story of his own father. But then his interaction with our Heavenly Father is saying, so where are you? Are you good? Are you not good? And I think to live that out, and so if I'm living it in my shoes, here's what I'm thinking. Do I like this song? Does it fit right here? What about today? What about, those are the things I think. But if I put myself in someone else's shoes, I think that song takes on even a bigger meaning, and I'm reminded, like, that's me as well. He's my Heavenly Father as well, and he is good, no matter what's going on in my life. I just think that idea of putting ourselves in someone else's shoes, it changes our interaction with each other. So how's your faith journey, and how's your faith journey been like here?
Yeah, it's been really hard, actually. My freshman year, I was diagnosed with generalized anxiety disorder. Not surprised. And my freshman year was the worst. I got here because faculty, I don't know if y'all remember Whitney Bosniak. She was Bosniak at the time. But she called me the summer before my senior year, and I had never heard of some trouble, and she had a long talk with me, and she prayed with me. And it was during that conversation that I realized that that God was calling me to do worship, and when I came and previewed here, I felt such a strong calling to come here, because there was something here that he had a purpose for me here. And my faith journey here, when I got here, almost immediately sunk. I got here and I wanted to get straight to the point. I was like, okay, God, why am I here? And he was just saying, tell me anything. I'm like, I'm kind of paying a lot of money for you not to talk to me. You know, coming from a poor family, like, I don't know how I got here. I almost dropped out of high school. But my freshman year was really hard. I was also in chapel band then. I didn't leave, but that was the whenever we would meet to practice for Friday chapel. I felt like that was the most spiritual growth I was getting. But other than that, my anxiety and depression got really, really bad. And especially this spring semester, I don't know what it was, because I remember like my sophomore year through my freshman year of college, literally every night I would pray to God and ask him to take it away. And because I believed he was a good God, I believed that he was the healer. But for some reason he wasn't taking this thing away. And I got mad at him, finally got fed up with it in my spring semester of freshman year here. And I was like, I'm tired of begging you. Like, you say that if we call upon your name, you'll come. But where are you? And, you know, finally got fed up with it. But the following summer, I was healed. And an amazing activity that I did. But after I was healed, I realized that, you know, he had me suffer through that for a reason. And now, like, I know my purpose here at this college, And when he told me, I was like, okay. My junior year, I had, I was having financial trouble. Somehow I owed $13,000 from the school, just out of nowhere. And I was like, okay, you brought me here for a reason. Now I have all this money that you know that I don't have and I cannot make up in a semester. And I was like, so I think it's about time you tell me why I'm here. And, you know, I just felt this rush of peace come over me. And he told me to love you. I'm here to love you, and I'm here to love you.
So can I ask a question along those lines? What would you want to leave with this group right here? From your journey, your whole faith journey, what would you want to leave with your fellow classmates and professors?
I talk a lot about life, and I think a lot about life. And consider your existence, consider your life and where you are now. Consider your past, consider where you will be in the future. Because in the end, it's your choice what you do with your life. There's no one telling you what to do besides yourself. God gave us free will, and you get to choose whether you follow what He wants you to do. In the end, it's your choice. It's your choice whether you pass this class. It's your choice whether it's your choice whether you try these drugs. It's your choice whether you go to this party and get messed up. I had a lot of experience with that. I became an alcoholic when I was 12. And so looking back at all these things in my life, I've learned how to consider these things. And like, I realize that it's my choice.
All right. Yes, do you think? I want to read one last story with you guys, and we're going to end with a chance to worship, to thank God because He is good. And what does it look like now for us personally to say, so it's easy to say the gospel cares for the lost and pretty, but what does it look like for you? You know, we don't see Jesus say, hey, here's 7 steps. We don't see the prophet say, here's 12 things you need to do. We don't have that, but I really do think that God gives us a really good explanation of what this looks like. This comes from Luke. Chapter 10. I'm going to walk through this pretty quick because I think the main point is right at the end. So get this story. One day, an expert in the religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? In fact, I would say he's saying this: Hey, what's this really all about? Tell me, how would you summarize all of this? And Jesus then says this: What does the law of Moses, how do you read it? And the man answered, You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Sounds like a good answer, right? Seems like a good answer. And Jesus says, Right, do this, and you will live. By the way, Jesus said, Right, you hit the nail on the head, that's it. You summarized it well, love God and love others. Olivia just a little bit ago said, You know, there's like this, and there's like this. And that's really right, love God and love others. But the guy's showing you a loophole. He's trying to kind of maybe figure out, so, okay, I've done this my whole life, maybe, but what is divine neighbor for me, right? So, starting in verse 29, the man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and they left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. By the way, this is the one that we think would stop, right? The priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant, a Levite, comes along and walked over. Get what he does here. He looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan. Now, I know a lot of you have heard this, but we have to get this. The Samaritan that we think of as the good guy in this story, the Samaritan was the despised person. They're half Jew, half not. They're sort of the outcast, the despised person. Look what they did. The despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed the wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them, took care of him right away with the needs that he had right then and there. Then he put him on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he could take care of him. So we know that he himself probably had to walk along the side as he takes care of this man. Then, the next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins. he tells him this. Take care of this man. His bill runs higher than this. I'll take care of it the next time I pass through. Now, which of these would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by the bandits? Jesus asked. And we kind of see it, don't we? The man answered, the one who showed him mercy. Then Jesus said, yes, now go and do the same. The gospel cares for the lost and hurting. What does it look like to walk in someone else's shoes? We are not able to decide who our neighbor is, are we? A neighbor is everyone that we come into contact with. So Central Christian College, no matter who you are, if you're a coach, if you're a student, if you're faculty, if you're staff, it doesn't matter who you are, we've been called to love our neighbor, which is anyone that we come into contact with. And by the way, we don't get the option to choose who our neighbor is. Because they look like us, or act like us, or talk like us, or do what we think they ought to do. We don't want to be the ones saying, stop it! We want to be the ones saying, I love you, and I care for you. Now, sometimes does that include asking someone to stop something? Absolutely. Out of love, you might come and say, as Jake shared his story, you know, you might say, you know, I've had experience with drug and alcohol, and I'm coming to you to say it. And I says, yeah. So don't get into that. I messed up my dad's life, messed up my childhood, took him from me. So maybe it involves that. What if it involves going and saying, I'm sorry, I apologize for how I've hurt you? What if it involves encouragement, prayer for someone who's walking alongside you? What does it look like for us, for you, to walk in someone else's shoes? You love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And you love your neighbor, weightless. You love everyone you come into contact with as yourself. Let's live that out here on campus. We're going to conclude with one worship song right here. And as we worship, here's what I want you to contemplate. Is this a chance for you now to say, how do I respond personally with this challenge that the gospel message gives me? Is there someone you need to go to and apologize? Is there someone who's struggling that you say, I can come alongside them and encourage them? You need to walk in their shoes. God loves us so much that he sent his only son to walk in our shoes and to take on what we couldn't take on, to care for us. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you do love us and that you do care for us. Thank you that your son, Jesus, came and walked in our shoes, that you love us that much. Help us to love everyone that we come into contact with that kind of love. Let Olivia's story and let Jake's story always remind us that we should be walking in other people's shoes, not judging and not condemning and not just walking on the other side of the road, but encouraging and lifting up. Help us to be good neighbors to those around us that we love with our heart, soul, mind, and strength. In Jesus' name we pray, and I'll say, amen. Yeah.
God, we came into this place knowing one thing, but we leave knowing another. And we thank you that we have been changed even since being here in this room today. I pray that when we leave these doors, that we become Christian neighbors to one another, real Christian neighbors, walking in your spirit, walking in love, walking in encouragement. Thank you, Jesus, for being here. And we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.